Ladies and gentlemen, you are most welcome to this lecture, which should be about stroke. And stroke is one of the most devastating diseases in clinical medicine, particularly when it comes to people who were leading quite an active, normal life, and suddenly the patient loses function, rendered incapacitated by stroke. So the objectives of this lecture is to define stroke, review the brain circulation, types of strokes, risk factors, pathophysiology, and then clinical features, clinical examination and investigations, important investigations like CT scan of the brain. And to define stroke, it's defined as sudden vascular blockage of the blood vessels leading to ischemia. And if not treated in a timely manner, then necrosis would start and the brain tissues are lost, leading to a neurological deficit that would be displayed on the area supplied by the particular artery which is blocked. To make this more easy, this illustrates the different parts of the brain and their blood supply. This includes the supratentorial area. The one in yellow is the anterior cerebral, the one in red is the midcerebral artery territory, and the one in blue is the posterior cerebral artery territory. This is the famous circle of Willis. And here, if you look at the upper part of it, this is the anterior circulation with the internal carotid artery dividing into, giving a branch, which is the anterior cerebral and the midcerebral arteries. And then the posterior circulation, the two vertebral arteries unite to form the basilar artery, which gives branches like anterior, inferior cerebellar arteries, the pontine arteries, and then it divides ultimately into the two posterior cerebral arteries. What's the pathophysiology? It could be infarction or it could be hemorrhagic. So ischemic stroke could be due to embolization or thrombosis, and hemorrhagic stroke could be due to intracerebral hemorrhage complicating uncontrolled hypertension or maybe aneurysmal dilatation in some cases. The midcerebral artery territory usually supplies the area which was on red on one of the previous slides, and it leads to contralateral hemiplegia, and usually with seventh cranial nerve affection, particularly when it's in the internal capsule. It would be both ipsilateral hemianopia, gaze towards, the patient looks towards the side of the lesion, there might be agnosia, receptive and expressive aphasia, and neglect of double stimulation. It would be appreciated as a single stimulus. The classification of stroke depends on the reversibility of the lesion. For instance, if the patient has got a reversible neurological deficit that clears away in the first 24 hours, then this is known as transient ischemic attack, while minor stroke reverses within the first 1 week, and complete stroke, it persists after the first 1 week. There is an entity known as stroke in evolution where the neurological deficit is propagated and continuously increasing, and usually it's due to thrombosis. What are the risk factors for a stroke? There are some non-modifiable risk factors like age and male, but there are plenty of modifiable factors such as hypertension, and by far this is the commonest risk factor for stroke: smoking, uncontrolled diabetes mellitus, dyslipidemia, atrial fibrillation, particularly the paroxysmal type, and there is a high incidence of strokes at the time of conversion from rhythm, one rhythm to another, like from the normal rhythm into the atrial fibrillation or vice versa. What are the clinical features? Abrupt onset of weakness, monoplegia, particularly in patients with space-occupying lesions, quadriplegia in patients with brainstem stroke, or if the patient is having double stroke. This is the other cause of quadriplegia. Visual field defect, visual loss, diplopia, dysarthria, aphasia, vertigo, nystagmus. Vertigo, nystagmus, and ataxia usually occurs in the posterior circulation tertiary strokes. The patient might have loss of consciousness if it's affecting the brainstem, or even if it's cortical but it's involving a large cortical area. This is the fast, and this is the fast way of diagnosing stroke. It involves F. F stands for the face, looking for facial asymmetry due to the upper motor neuron facial palsy. Arms looking for a drift, and speech, any speech abnormality might point out to the presence of stroke. So this is a very fast way. Even the caregivers of a patient, his family, the EMS, that's the emergency medical services, with this fast, they can recognize stroke early on and transfer the patient urgently to the nearest stroke unit. What's the differential diagnosis of stroke? Hypoglycemia, seizure, meningitis, specific lesion. One of the important differential diagnoses that we have to consider. There is a long list that you can have a look at in one of your textbooks. And approaching the patient, you have to take a quick history about his age, comorbidities. Also, we have to look at the onset of the stroke, any seizures with the stroke, fever that might point out to meningitis, cough as a complication of stroke, they might have an aspiration pneumonia. And you have also to consider thrombolytic therapy if the patient is presenting in the first 4.5 hours. So you have to make sure the patient is not actively bleeding from any side and he doesn't have any recent surgery. Of course, the vital signs needs to be checked early on. And then the ABCs, like for every patient. Then we have to confirm the presence of a stroke. FAST points out the stroke. We can assess the patient looking for the neurological deficit, seventh cranial nerve palsy, and the gait if the patient is able to walk. So while we're doing the clinical examination, we would like to rule out the important differentials that we have just mentioned and to set a baseline for follow-up and to look at the extent and severity of the stroke. Regarding the neurological examination, I have put everything here in details because we are in the era of corona and the training in hospitals is a bit in jeopardy nowadays for the medical students and the residents. So look at the mental status, the language, the cranial nerves, then the motor, looking at the power, reflexes, the sensations, both superficial and deep, and gait. And of course, this is in a stable patient, probably outside the emergency room. When the patient is stable and he's in the ward and everything, then you go for detailed neurological examination. Other systems need also to be assessed, particularly the cardiovascular system, looking for atrial fibrillation, valvular heart disease, and ischemic heart disease. The chest, looking for aspiration pneumonia, abdominal masses, masses anywhere, skin, looking for maculopapular rash, particularly in febrile patients, because meningitis is one of the most important differentials. And we have to look at the skin and musculoskeletal skin, looking for anything that points to connective tissue disease, particularly SLE. Investigations, we have to do the complete blood count, looking for anemia and polycythemia. Any ECG changes, biochemistry is also important. And then CT scan of the brain, we should proceed as quickly as possible, not to miss any time. If it's normal, then probably we would proceed for MRI in stroke centers. And if the patient is less than 50 years old, then it's important to do the autoimmune screening. Other neurological examinations, fundoscopy to rule out increased intracerebral pressure. And this is the CT scan. As we have mentioned, anterior cerebral artery territory is in red here, and the middle cerebral artery light green, the posterior cerebral artery in dark green. If you focus on this and rehearse it very well, then you would be able to diagnose the different cerebral artery branches on the CT scan for your patients. For instance, this is the middle cerebral artery infarction, and the one on the right is hemorrhage. And hemorrhage is hyperdense. Its density is quite like the bone, while the ischemia, I mean the infarction, would be shown up as a hypodensity on the brain CT scan. This is an extensive infarction, probably involving the internal carotid artery, because both anterior and mid-cerebral artery are involved in this patient. And the other CT scan on the right side is showing intracerebral hemorrhage in the territory of the mid-cerebral artery. This is the posterior cerebral artery infarction. And by this, we come to the end of our lecture. Thank you so much. In the next lecture, I will be talking about the treatment of stroke. Thank you so much. Stay home, stay safe.